Good morning, everyone. We're delighted to have Dima Krotov from the Institute of Advanced Study tell us about dense associative memories and deep learning.
Hello, everybody. Well, first of all, thanks so much for the invitation. The work that I'm going to present is about the relationship between sort of two sets of ideas that exist within the field of neural networks. One set of ideas is known under the name of associative memory models, and the second set of ideas is familiar deep learning. And since I'm sure that most of you guys are probably experts on deep learning, but perhaps some of you are slightly less familiar with associative memory models, I thought that it would be helpful if I start with associative memories and then I'm going to make connections with deep learning. So that would be my strategy. And please, you know, feel free to ask any questions during the talk. So basically, what is associative memory? Associative memory is essentially a neural network. And the unusual thing about this neural network is that it has something that is called an energy function. And the energy function is a scalar quantity that depends on the activities of all the neurons that are part of the neural network. And the idea is that we would like to design the shape of this energy function in such a way so that it has a bunch of local minimum. And each local minima, ideally, we would like it to correspond to some semantically meaningful pattern. And the patterns can be images or pieces of text or audio files. It doesn't really matter. But what is important is that indeed there is an energy and it has like a bunch of local minima that are well separated. And at the bottom of each minimum, we will have a vector that is denoted here by this letter xi. And the upper index of this vector will indicate the number of this local minima. And in principle, there is also a lower index in this vector that is not shown in this slide, which corresponds to the projection of that pattern into the space of neurons. So that's the idea. And the typical computation that such system can do is the following. We can start from some initial space, some initial state in the space of configurations of all the neurons, like the one shown by this red ball. And let this ball roll down the energy until it reaches one of the local minima. And once it does so, we can say that associative memory has retrieved one of the memory states from the pool of memories. And that's the reason why this construction is called a memory. And the reason why it is called an associative memory is because it tends to associate the initial state where we start this red ball in the final state where it ends up being after, you know, a long period of time following the dynamics. So let me give you a couple of basic examples of how people use this construction. Imagine, for example, that we are trying to deal with high-resolution images, and we would like to design an associative memory that has memorized a bunch of those images. And let's start from some initial state, like the one shown in this slide, where you can see a beak of some bird. But three quarters of the image are removed. And then we can let associative memory to compute the completion of that pattern. And as you can see, as dynamics progresses, as this ball rolls down the energy landscape, the associative memory retrieves the entire image of the lorikeet from the pool of memories. So this is kind of one typical use of associative memories. On the right, you can see a different kind of test case, which is the following. I have taken a nice image and I have heavily corrupted it with noise. So basically, 98% of pixels are replaced by white Gaussian noise. And you pretty much can't see any semantic content in that image, right? But again, if we give it to associative memory and run temporal dynamics, you can see that associative memory recalls that state. And if you look at it carefully, when I play it the next time, you can see that somewhere along these dynamics, there is a little bit of a lorikeet over there, right? So indeed, the associative memory has to choose between a bunch of local minima where to go down to. But once it does so, it recovers the nice content of the memory. So that's the idea. Now, let's try to make this idea a little bit more mathematically defined. And on the left part of this slide, you see the energy function, which corresponds to something that I'm going to call standard model of associative memory. So let's try to understand this formula. In this formula, sigma i's are activities of neurons. So in total, I will have capital N neurons, and the indices I and j will enumerate different neurons in my neural network. And in the simplest case, each neuron will be a binary variable sigma I, which can be equal either minus one if the neuron is in the off state or plus one if the neuron is in the on state. And the shape of this energy function is encoded in this matrix Tij, which is so-called matrix of synaptic connections. And in the most naive form, this matrix is simply given by the outer product of the memory vectors. So xi's here are exactly the same xi's as I have introduced on the previous slide. So the upper index mu enumerates different patterns, and there are capital K of those patterns. And the lower index I and j, they enumerate projections into the space of neurons. So very simple formula. So sometimes this construction is also known as Hopfield net, if that rings any bells. So it's been known for a while that this energy function works as a nice model of associative memory, provided that the number of patterns or number of memories k that we store in it should be smaller than a certain bound. And in this specific case, this bound is equal to this well-known result, 0.14n. Where, again, capital N is the size of the neural network, or the number of neurons, and 0.14 is some numerical constant that comes out of some, you know, statistical mechanics calculation. And it turns out that if the number of memories K is smaller than this bound, then it works nicely. And if we are trying to put more memories, yes?
In what sense works nicely? What's the precise statement?
The precise statement is the following, that we can put some number of memories, and then we can start from random state in the configuration space. We can follow the dynamical trajectory, and the associative memory will retrieve one of those states. So there are no any other local minima that we would like not to remember. And if we are trying to pack in more memories than this number, then in addition to all the local minima that we are trying to memorize, all the patterns that we would like to remember, there will be many other local minima that have nothing to do with the patterns that we are trying to deal with. And that's kind of the well-known problem. In physics, this problem is called the problem of spin glasses and or spurious states. And, you know, there is a lot of literature written on this subject.
So pretty much the question is how, like, can you park that many prescribed local minima?
Yeah, exactly. And it turns out that for this simple Hamiltonian with only quadratic interactions between the neurons, that's so it turns out that you can do it a little bit better than that. You can, the maximal number of memories with a slightly different version of the energy function that can be packed into the system is equal to 2n. But what is important is that it grows linearly with the size of the network. And what I'm going to show you in on the right-hand side grows much faster than that. So let me get to that.
Mm-hmm. Arbitrary patterns, or this is for random patterns?
Right. So technically, this specific result is obtained for random patterns. So indeed, you assume that not only the sigmas are binary variables, but also xi's are binary variables, and they come from a probability distribution, so that can be equal to minus one or plus one with equal probability. But it turns out that this bound, in fact, is that you can derive analytically for random patterns is the real, if you start working with real patterns, which are not binary and not random, you can also see that, you know, the number of memories that you can store is more or less in the same ballpark.
That's an empirical statement.
That's an empirical statement, indeed. So this calculation is rigorously done for random patterns drawn from, you know, very specific distribution. Right. Okay, so there is this problem. And this problem raises the question, can we somehow modify this construction so that this upper limit either does not arise at all, or at least arises at a much larger number of memories? And this question brings up something that I'm going to call dense associative memories. So dense associative memories are also energy-based models, and their energy function is given by this formula. So let's try to understand this formula. And in order to do that, let's go back for a second to the standard case. So if we take this expression for the matrix Tij and plug it into the expression for the energy function, you can easily see that one can rearrange the sum over this index mu and these indices I and j so that the energy can be rewritten in this simple form, right? So basically, the expression in the brackets here is the overlap between the vector of activities of the neurons and one of the memory vectors. And then we take the second power of that overlap. So the only difference between the standard case and the dense case is that instead of raising that overlap into the second power, I'm going to raise it into some power n. And in general, I will be interested in situations when this power n is greater or equal than 2. So if n is equal to 2, then this is a standard model. But if n is bigger than 2, then it's a very different Hamiltonian. And the reason why it is a different Hamiltonian is because now it has many-body interactions. As you can see, this Hamiltonian is no longer quadratic in spins. So potentially, it can have like completely different computational properties. And by and large, kind of the main content of my talk would be investigating the computational properties of these funny Hamiltonians. So now if we repeat this calculation for the capacity of these models with this nonlinear Hamiltonian, we can arrive at the following result, that the maximal number of memories that such system can store now scales like capital N to the power N minus 1. And as you can see, this is a very different formula from this one. If little n is equal to 2, then of course it also grows linearly. But if n is greater than 2, then it grows much, much, much faster than linearly. And the typical applications that I'm going to show you today, they require capital N, the number of the neurons, to be of the order of 1,000 or 1,000,000, and little n, the power, will be of the order of 5 or 10. And as you can see, in that regime, the memory storage capacity of these models is much, much, much bigger than the memory storage capacity of the quadratic models. And that's kind of the essence of the theoretical phenomenon that I'm going to use for the applications.
So I guess the initial question, why are you, probably has some like external meaning, but why are you restricted to functions of this kind? I mean, if you want to just design functions with like prescribed local minimum, you can come up with some polynomial or something like this. So why?
You mean why we're using monomial function as opposed to a sum of several degrees, or?
Why you use functions of that specific kind? Is it easier to optimize or something?
Well, so in some sense, at some point I was going to make some connection between these models and multivariate perceptrons that people use in deep learning.
Oh, okay.
And in order to do that, it's nicer to have this function to be a monomial function, because it turns out that this function will have something to do with the activation functions that people use in deep learning. And sometimes people interpret those activation functions as firing rates of biological neurons. And for that reason, they have to, you know, satisfy certain properties. But in principle, you're right. We can write any function here. And the only kind of insight that we can gain from this theory is that it should have a large capacity. So in principle, for example, there was a very nice recent paper where people extended this construction to an exponential function. And for an exponential function, people showed that indeed you can even achieve an exponential memory storage complexity. And of course, the total number of states here is 2 to the power n, right? If you have n neurons and each of them is binary, then you cannot exceed 2 to the power n. But I think what people showed is that you can achieve exponent of n multiplied by 2 divided by log 2 or something like that. So it's some numerical constant that grows slower than 2n, but it's still exponential.
Good question. As you just said, the number of patterns cannot exceed 2 to the power of n, but your k-max formula doesn't account for that. It seems like you can keep on going forever.
Exactly. No, it's all these formulas are derived in the limit when k is much smaller than 2 to the power n. Then they have to be modified if you know, hit that bound. So we are in the regime when these bounds are much, much, much smaller than that bound. Okay, so let me now try to apply this idea to solve some, you know, minimally meaningful tasks. And let's start with something very simple, which is classification of handwritten digits from the MNIST dataset. Of course, we all know how to solve this problem using multivariate perceptrons or deep neural nets, but how can we do this using associative memory models? And here is the idea. So imagine that we have images like this one. So pretty much grayscale 8-bit intensities images, which are 28 by 28 pixels. So what we can do, we can take a vector of visible neurons so that each neuron corresponds to the intensity of a given pixel and arrange them into a vector of visible neurons, which will have 784 units. But now we're going to add another 10 neurons to this configuration space of the neural network that would be responsible for the classification decision. And pretty much the information in those 10 neurons will be organized in a one-hot encoding way. So if this is a digit 2, then all the neurons but the second should be in the minus 1 state, and the second neuron should be somewhat activated. And then we can apply associative memory in the following sense. Like, remember this little simulation with the lorikeet, where I have presented an incomplete pattern and I have let associative memory to complete the pattern. So now we're going to think about this incomplete queue as the MNIST image. And the rest of the image will be the label that needs to be completed. And that's kind of the idea of how one can use associative memories for the classification task. Okay, so now it turns out that one can define all these dynamical rules in such a way so that they are continuous and fully differentiable. And if we do that, then we can train these nets using a backpropagation algorithm. So essentially what I'm going to do, I'm going to start with some random memory vectors, xi's, that are drawn from some smooth distribution, say, you know, normal distribution with zero mean and a small variance. And then I'm going to iteratively update the states of those memory vectors in such a way so that the network becomes better and better at the classification task on the training set. And then after I train this net for a long time, it will arrive at some constructed set of vectors xi's. And the next question that I would like to discuss is the following. What do these constructed representations look like? In other words, what kind of information did the neural network extract from the data set? And it turns out the answer to that question heavily depends on this power of nonlinearity n, because for different values of n, it will extract very different semantic information from the data set. So let me get to that. But first, I'd like to say a couple of general words about how people think about theories of pattern recognition in cognitive sciences. And the reason why I would like to do that is because, as you'll see in a moment, this will have a very close relationship to this power n that I have introduced earlier. So in cognitive psychology and neuroscience, people sort of think about two extreme views on the theory of pattern recognition. They're called the feature matching theory and the prototype theory. The feature matching theory is inspired by these famous experiments done in the 60s by Hubel and Weisel, who essentially discovered the existence of direction selective cells. So what these people did, they took an anesthetized cat and put the cat in front of the screen and put a little electrode into the visual cortex of the cat and recorded the activities of the cells. And at the same time, they projected bars with various kinds of orientations on the screen. And what they discovered is that there are cells in the visual cortex that selectively respond to bars at a certain orientation. So there are cells that respond to horizontal bars, there are cells that respond to bars that are rotated by 10 degrees, and so on. So pretty much for every orientation, there is a group of cells that respond. And this observation inspired the following idea that is very popular among people who work on deep neural nets, that when a new image is presented to the animal, that image is first decomposed into a set of elementary patterns that are detected by feature detector cells. And then the activities of these feature detector cells are sent into higher areas of the brain where there are other cells that detect features of features. And this process continues for many steps while making features bigger and bigger and bigger until the top layer where the actual classification is made. So this is kind of one idea, and as you can see, it is clearly kind of the main inspiration behind having deep architectures in artificial neural networks. But in principle, there is another idea, and that alternative idea comes from experiments done in the 80s by these two people, by Sosa and McCarthy. So in this set of experiments, an image of a human face, like the one that is shown in this slide, was used as a prototype. From which they constructed a bunch of descendant faces using techniques from computer graphics. So basically, they took images of a bunch of faces and then they swapped various facial features, for example, the shape of the nose or the shape of the lips and so on. And by doing so, they have constructed this data set that is shown in this two-dimensional plane. So the face that is shown at the center is the prototype face. And the arrangement of the descendant faces is such that the farther the face is from the center, the less similar that face is to the prototype. So the faces that are shown in the circle number one are very similar to the prototype. And the faces that are shown in the circle number four are very dissimilar to the prototype. So once this data set was constructed, it was split into two halves. The training set that is shown in blue and the test set, that would be a combination of blue and red images. So during training time, they invited a bunch of undergraduate students to the lab and they have shown them examples of the familiar faces, the blue faces. And the undergraduates were instructed to memorize those faces. In the test time, the same human subjects were shown examples of the familiar faces, examples of the unfamiliar faces, and the prototype face. And the task was to distinguish the familiar faces from the unfamiliar faces. The experiments have shown two results. First of all, the undergraduate students were quite good at distinguishing the familiar faces from the unfamiliar faces. So they indeed somehow memorized those faces. But what was very surprising that somehow they thought that they had seen the prototype face before. Although, as you can see, the prototype face was unfamiliar, so it is shown in red. So it was never actually shown at training time. Yet the students thought that they had seen that face. And that has led to an inspiration to the idea that perhaps when humans are exposed to a bunch of exemplars, they tend to abstract them to several prototypes and they tend to memorize those prototypes. And then when a new image comes in, the classification decision on that image is judged based on the degree of similarity between the newly presented image and one of those memorized prototypes. So there are two these extreme regimes. And historically, that alternative view is very popular among people who work on Gestalt psychology, for example. Okay, so why am I talking about this? The reason is because it turns out that the constructed representations or the memory vectors that these neural networks learn, they heavily depend on this power of nonlinearity n. And for small values of this power, they tend to represent feature detectors. And for large values of this power, they tend to represent prototypes. So let me explain this point in a little bit more details. So in this slide, you can see randomly selected, 25 randomly selected memory vectors out of 2,000, I think, memory vectors for which all these four neural networks are trained for models with n equals 2, n equals 3, n equals 20, and n equals 30. And each little square, like the one highlighted by the green frame, represents one memory. And it is arranged so that, you know, the element of the memory that couples to pixel I is plotted in the location of that pixel. So this pretty much corresponds to the MNIST image, right? And the color code here is such that the blue color energetically favors dark pixels, the red color energetically favors bright pixels, and the white color corresponds to pixels that can be either on or off. So the energy does not depend on whether or not they are active. So if we take a look at the one of the memory vectors for n equals 2, we see that indeed, for example, this guy clearly represents a feature detector. So it's some pattern that is useful for recognizing a digit 2 if you plot it like this, right? But it is also useful for recognizing a digit 8 or a digit 0 or a bunch of other digits. So it serves as a feature detector. In contrast, if we look at one of the memory vectors for n equals 30, it represents a prototype of a single digit. And if we gradually change the power n from n equals 2 to n equals 30, we see a gradual transition from features to prototype. So this is the phenomenon that I call feature to prototype transition in the constructed representations that these models learn. And
Where is the representation in the network?
So the representation is in the parameters. So I am training the neural net to find those letters xi. So xi are weights, right? And I train this net using backprop to find the weights in a standard way. Like we train, you know, multi-layer perceptrons, we iteratively adjust the weights. And once I have finished training, I have these weights, and this is the representation that shows those weights.
So how is the picture related to the weights?
Now, how is this picture?
So you have the weights. How do you obtain those pictures?
So we have the weights. So you take one memory which has 784 neurons. Let's forget about the 10 neurons that are responsible for classification for a second. So you take those 784 neurons, and you rearrange those elements into 28 by 28 image. In the same way like you did to convert the initial image to the 784-dimensional vector. And then you plot this 28 by 28 image in one little square. And the color code here represents the value of that weight. So all the weights, they can change between minus 1 and plus 1, right? And the color indicates the value of that particular memory element.
So these are pictures of weights. Yeah. They're not of the memories.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, they're memories, right?
Weights
are memories. These are not data.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the capital K that you had, you said that was 2,000.
Yeah.
So what I understand here is if you're on the left side, it has to basically, there's a sum over all the K, the 2,000 vectors. So it's summing up a lot, I guess.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
And eventually, if you sum up enough matching ones, then the correct, you know,
yeah.
1 out of 10, 1 hot vector arises. Whereas yeah. on the right-hand side, there seems to be one that's dominating
yeah.
because you have a high exponent.
Exactly.
That's explaining this, right?
Yeah, that's exactly the okay. intuition. That's exactly what is happening. Indeed, it's not quite true to say that only one memory vector makes the entire classification decision, but it turns out that there is a hierarchical contribution. So, like the typical classification decision is made by one or two or three or five memories. And for small values of n, it will take like 10 memories or 15 memories. Yeah, sorry, yeah.
You said you're using backprop. How does that work here?
So backprop works in a standard way. So pretty much you can define all the dynamical updates rules so they're continuous functions. And then as the input, you give the image of the, you know, of the MNIST digit, and then as the output, you produce this 10 vector that corresponds to the label. And then you simply define an objective function in some standard way. It can be cross entropy or it can be...
gradient descent.
And then you do gradient descent, exactly.
Yeah, but you don't have backpropagation of sorts.
Yeah, okay, fine. Yes, it is stochastic gradient descent.
And,
yeah.
And then it seems like all the input images are coupled in a way in that computation, or you can, I have to look at the...
In what sense are they coupled? No,
well, it seems like you can have to look, they're not.
No, you can do online, you can do mini batches, you can do full batch.
So you just do gradient descent.
Yeah, it's stochastic gradient descent, exactly.
Can you show the function again that you end up with?
The function...
The energy function.
The energy function, yes. Yeah.
All right, because you're summing over the patterns.
Yeah, we're summing over the patterns, and now index I should also include those 10 neurons.
So this is very fast. It's much faster than the deep network.
Well, it depends on the depth, but yeah, you can, if you're comparing with a very deep net, it's much faster. Yeah. Yeah.
And also, when you take derivatives of this, it doesn't seem like higher ends are making things slower.
No,
it seems like it doesn't matter at all.
It doesn't matter at all. Computers are very fast at raising, you know, numbers into, you know.
Well, derivative also, it doesn't, even though there's so much coupling there, your gradient descent is very simple.
Absolutely. Computational complexity of training these dense associative memories is equal to the computational complexity of, you know, back prop or stochastic gradient descent.
Have you tried to use this to maybe generate the data?
You
like
could.
Starting,
you could.
Instead of testing, like starting from a random point, do you generate, you know, then if you go to local minima, that corresponds to digits?
Yes, right. We did try to do that. And indeed, okay, let me, it kind of, you're jumping.
I'm going to make a suggestion that maybe we, you know, go through the talks and just ask questions related to understanding, and then the questions about we'll do towards the end.
Yes, okay. I will address your question later, but basically this is the answer. So it turns out that, yes, you can do that. But let me get back to it. For all values of n, you can do that, but it's somewhat more meaningful for large n. Okay. Okay, so just to wrap up this little discussion, in principle, a pixel permutation invariant MNIST task is, of course, a standard benchmark. There are thousands of papers written on the subject. And if you train deep neural nets with simple backprop or stochastic gradient descent without dropout, adversarial training, or any fancy optimizers, on this task you can get like 1.5-1.6%. And dense associative memories pretty much fall into the same ballpark for all values of power n. So these are pretty decent, you know, classifiers. Okay. Yeah, it's slightly worse, but don't read too much into that. I mean, you know, for example, for n equals 20, it is as good as what you would do with deep neural nets. Yeah. Yeah. So if you raise n to a very high number, then you will do worse, because then you will simply do nearest neighbor classification, and you don't want to go quite that far. You still want to keep some kind of, you know, degree of cooperativity between different hidden units. But it turns out for n equals 30, that's the right kind of amount, or n equals 20. Okay, so how is this all related to deep learning and multi-layer perceptrons? In this diagram on the left, you can see the standard, you know, feed-forward neural net with one hidden layer. So the rules of the games are standard. So there are visible neurons. The visible neurons are multiplied by some matrix, and the result is passed through some nonlinearity f of x. And then we repeat the same thing for a couple of more steps, and then we obtain the classification decision. And then we train the whole thing with backprop. On the right, you can see this schematic diagram that represents the kind of computation that associative memory is doing. And again, so to repeat it one more time, we have the visible neurons that are clumped to the intensities of the pixels, and we have the classification neurons that are initialized in the off state when all of them are in the minus one state, and then we update them. And we can update them once, or we can update them twice. It is within our hands, so we can update them several times. So let's imagine for a second that we allow them to be updated only once. And if we are in that regime, then it turns out that there is a simple mathematical relationship between the computation that associative memory is doing and a feed-forward neural net with one layer is doing. And it turns out that the computation that they are doing is exactly the same if the activation function that projects from the visible layer into the first hidden layer is equal to the derivative of the energy function. So if that matching rule is satisfied, then these two networks are identical. It's a mathematical theorem, if you wish. And this is kind of an interesting observation, because In deep learning, we like to use these rectified linear units, right, for training deep neural nets. And now if we take this activation function and transform it through this dictionary into the language of energy-based models, we see that the energy function will be quadratic, right? And quadratic energy functions are in the same universality class as standard Hopfield nets. So in some sense, there is some relationship between standard Hopfield nets and rectified linear, you know, multi-error perceptrons with rectified linear units. But now we have these dense memories, right, which correspond to non-linear functions f of x. If we transform them back to the language of multi-error perceptrons, then it turns out that the activation function would be a rectified polynomial of power n minus 1, right? And that's kind of interesting because this is a very untypical choice for the activation functions. Nobody uses these functions. But now, since we have this duality in our hands, we understand something about computational properties of multi-layer perceptrons with these fancy activation functions. In particular, we know now that there is a feature to prototype transition if we increase the steepness of this activation function, right? So let me get back to that in a second, but let me discuss the following question. Can we somehow use these models for solving some, you know, minimally practically relevant tasks? And let me again start with a task which is not quite practically relevant, but I will get to more exciting tasks. But let me discuss the conceptual problem. So the conceptual problem that I'm going to talk about is the problem of adversarial inputs. So I'm sure that probably most of you are well familiar with this problem, but just to rephrase it in a slightly different way, so we can train a neural net to classify MNIST digits, and we can take some raw image from the data set, give it to neural net, and the neural net will tell us that this is a digit 2. And then we can change a few pixels in that image so that we can generate the image that is shown on the right. We give it to the same neural net, and the neural net will tell us that this is something else. And there are sort of two aspects of this problem. The first aspect of the problem is that the initial image and the adversarial image, they look very similar to each other. And for this reason, it's kind of highly unnatural that they are classified differently. That's one aspect of the problem. And the second aspect of the problem is that if we take a look at the deformation that has led us from this image into this image, by and large, we don't see any semantic features of a digit 3 in it. So for all practical purposes, this deformation looks like some kind of noise that is added to the image. It doesn't have any features of a digit 3. So what can we do with this problem with dense associative memories? It turns out that all these problems that are well familiar in the deep learning framework are also present in associative memories with n equals 2. So pretty much you can take raw images that are shown in this column, you can generate the adversarial images, and they have all the same problems that I have just described. But now if we go all the way to the models with n equals 30, we see a somewhat different picture. So let's take a look at this. So again, in this column, you can see raw images taken from the test set or training set. For this case, it doesn't really matter. And on the right, you can see the adversarial images that are constructed in such a way so that they sit right on the decision boundary between the raw image and the target class. So the target class in this case is 8. And so pretty much this image is classified as 50% 2 and 50% 8 by the neural net. But now you start seeing semantic features of the target class in those images, right? So it looks like there is a ghost digit 8 hidden behind the digit 2. Or in this case, it looks like the digit 9 and the digit 4 are morphed together in one image. Or here you can see like a superposition of 5 and 6. So in some sense, those decision boundaries now not only start to make sense from the perspective of neural networks, but they also start to make sense from the perspective of humans, if you wish. And that's kind of what you would like to accomplish if you're trying to tackle this problem. Okay, so far I have talked only about MNIST, and you would say that, you know, MNIST is so simple that probably anything could work on MNIST. And it's a big question whether or not these ideas could be, you know, translated to something more meaningful. So let me now talk a little bit about how one could apply these ideas of dense associative memories for classification of high resolution images. And I'm moving more towards ImageNet kind of tasks. So let me explain how I'm going to do this. This is the computational graph of the neural network that I'm going to use. And the lower layers here that are shown in pink are taken from the convolutional neural net that is called VGG16. It's a nice convolutional neural net that was a winner of the ImageNet competition a few years ago. And the green layers that are shown here are fully connected layers that live on top of VGG16. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to get rid of those. I'm going to throw them away. And instead of them, I'm going to put dense associative memory on top. So I'm going to use the convolutional and pooling layers from VGG16. And on top of that, I'm going to put dense associative memory. And then I'm going to train the whole thing on a bunch of, you know, high resolution images. So let's see what we can get by doing that. Let me again start not quite with ImageNet. Let me start with a so-called flower dataset. So the flower dataset comes with images, high resolution images of flowers. These are now real images. And images can be quite sophisticated. You can see a few examples here. And but there are only five classes. So there are daisies, dandelions, roses, sunflowers, and tulips. So we can train this framework to classify those flowers. We can take some image, which is clearly a sunflower. We can generate the adversarial deformation. And this is the deformed image. And the deformed image given to the same neural net is classified as a tulip. And again, you clearly see that there is a problem here, right? So now let me try to do the following experiments. So let's take some image from the data set. This is an image of a daisy, I guess. And let's try to generate two adversarial images from it. One using quadratic Hamiltonians, quadratic dense associative memories, and the other one using dense associative memories with n equals 8. And the target class for both images would be tulip. Now we're going to take those images and we're going to cross-classify them using the same two models. So we're going to take this image and give it to the model with n equals 2. And as you can see, by definition, that model is confused. So it thinks that this is a tulip. But now if we take that image and transfer it to the nonlinear model, to the model with n equals 8, that model is not confused. So it thinks that this is a daisy. And that's kind of what you would like to accomplish in some sense. You would like nonlinear models to be somewhat more robust to these kind of pathologies. Now, if we do the opposite experiment, we take this initial image, we generate an adversarial image using the nonlinear network, and now we classify it using the linear quadratic network and the nonlinear network with n equals 8. You can see that both models are confused. So in some sense, the adversarial images generated by the nonlinear network, they tend to be stronger adversaries than the adversarial images generated by the quadratic models. And that's kind of another interesting aspect of this problem. And this is the same result, but stated in a slightly more quantitative terms. So this is a table, and each row of this table corresponds to the model that is used for generation of images. And each column corresponds to the model that is used for the classification. And at the intersection, you see the error rates. So if we generate the images using n equals 2 and classify them using n equals 2, we get 100% error rate. So they're totally confused. And the same happens for n equals 8. But now if we transfer these images to nonlinear network, the error drops to 30%. And if we do the transfer the other way around from nonlinear networks to the linear networks, the error also drops because we do transfer to a different net. But it drops by a smaller amount. So these are kind of the two features that we see here. And to say them in words one more time, this number indicates that the nonlinear models are more robust to adversarial inputs, and this number indicates that nonlinear models are stronger adversaries than the linear models of quadratic Hamiltonians. Okay, so the ImageNet work is still in progress. So we trained it on the full ImageNet, 1.2 million images, 1,000 different classes. And so the accuracy that we got was 69%. And it does not look very impressive if you compare it with ResNets or Inception models, of course. But let me remind you that the corresponding benchmark in the top one classification for VGG16 is 72%.
Is this still VGG16 with yeah. The top change?
Yeah,
and
exactly.
You don't backpropagate into the VGG?
You backpropagate all the way.
All the way. You
yeah.
Start with VGG, but then you
yeah.
Backpropagate.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So you do not freeze the lower weights. It's not like transfer learning. You retrain it. No, in the first, you do freeze them, yeah. Thanks for this question. You could. I mean, again, kind of this is a research idea, right? So we start with simple things, and then we make them more and more kind of complicated. Right, but it has all these skip layer connections, right? And it's kind of... Okay, I agree. This is something that needs to be done. So we haven't tried ResNets yet, but yeah. But at least on VGG, it works nicely. Let me just skip this and let me jump to my conclusion. So basically, as a conclusion, I would like to say the following, that we like to play with these funny nonlinear Hamiltonians that we call dense associative memories. And so far, we see three interesting properties of these Hamiltonians. So from the perspective of statistical mechanics or memory models, they have a much bigger capacity than standard memory models of associative memory. From the perspective of computer science, they are they're much more robust to adversarial inputs. And from the perspective of psychology and neuroscience, they have this interesting feature to prototype transition, which is simply regulated by the power of this nonlinearity. And we kind of keep playing with these models, and we hope to add a few more errors here in the future. And, you know, there are also these two papers, if you guys are interested in more technical details, and we also have some code that is available on GitHub. So thanks.
Skip through the last few pictures, which were informative.
Yeah. So these are just, you know, people like to talk about the kind of mistakes that these neural nets are making. And I thought these two are somewhat funny because indeed kind of something that contributes to this 69% accuracy in the top one classification decision, there are several kinds of mistakes, right? So this kind of mistake, which is a mistake, which is the following, that the label that dense associative memory assigns to this image is a moving one, and the correct label is a police van, which is a different class. And this image is kind of funny because the correct label is a bell code. And the dense associative memory coupled to VGG16 thinks that this is a guillotine. And it's kind of funny because, you know, if you have a little bit of imagination, you can see how it can be a guillotine, right? It's a very kind of efficient guillotine which has many blades in it. Yeah. So what else can I show you? I can show you a bunch of other examples that are make this kind of robustness property more visual. So again, these are images that are generated using quadratic models, and then you can see that all of them confuse quadratic models, and they're not, they do not confuse nonlinear models.
So these results on being more robust to these adversarial examples, is it mostly because you actually have a generative model on the top? You're modeling the full distribution over the data. And in that sense, with the original way they were training deep networks with stacked RDMs,
yeah,
would that also end up having less sensitivity to adversarial examples?
I don't think that generative model is kind of the core of this phenomenon, because, you know, people try to, you know, use autoencoders to derive those weights, and they try to fine-tune them using, you know, on the classification task, and it doesn't work. So it's not that the generative model is crucial. I think what is crucial is essentially the same phenomenon that leads us to a bigger capacity. And let me go back to it. So essentially, the phenomenon, the way I understand it, is the following, that these nonlinear models, they have a much kind of deeper basins of attraction. And that's and not only those basins of attraction are deeper, but in the quadratic Hamiltonians, the shape of those basins of attraction, they are kind of very fuzzy. So the boundary, the decision boundaries are somewhat like fractal-like. They have all this like brittleness in the decision boundaries.
Then you also overtrain.
You don't. You don't. Why do you think that you overtrain? You would overtrain if the size of those basins of attraction would be smaller, but it's not. So the size of those basins of attraction is of the order of capital O of the size of the network. So you don't like gain larger memory capacity by shrinking the size of the basins. So I that's my intuition of what is happening.
Original structure, so that you have something like a back-off mechanism or something like that?
You could do that, yeah. Yeah, there are all kinds of kind of these engineering opportunities of how one can apply them to.
You haven't tried it yet, just putting them together.
Yeah, we haven't tried that. We kind of, we were interested to see the, again, the phenomenon. But kind of if we move to more towards practical applications, that's of course something that might be valuable, yeah.
So I had a question. I mean, when you move to ImageNet and the more kind of difficult tasks,
yeah.
Then you did this thing of stacking your memory on top of one of the conventional convolutional neural networks. But I thought you were going to tell us that, I mean, from the build-up, I thought you just said, hey, just change the activation to like ReLU to the power of 17 and don't stack anything. Just, you know, make that three line of change code in TensorFlow and just retrain and that's it.
Yeah, unfortunately, so why I cannot make that statement. Yeah, it's not that easy. Yes. So
why not? What did I misunderstand? I mean, you.
So, I mean, I think that eventually it would be nice to kind of to modify some activations in the convolutional layers as well. But again, this is kind of work in progress. So what we understand so far that is that if you change those activations at the top, then somehow the whole decision boundaries become somewhat more smooth. But yeah, I mean...
So it's not true that ReLU squared is better than ReLU?
I think it might be true, but you cannot, I mean, it's, so let me put it that way. So if you work on MNIST, it works literally the way you said it. So you simply change, you know, rectified linear units by rectified parabolas or rectified cubic functions, and you can see that the higher the power is, the better, the more robust the network is. So that's exactly what is happening. On ImageNet, you have to do that, of course, but you also don't want to lose classification accuracy because, you know, convolutional neural nets, they are optimized to deal with translational invariants, to deal with rescalings, and somehow we don't yet understand how to couple all those nice properties with, you know, these fancy activation functions. So I think that at some point, something of that sort might emerge, but we're not quite there yet.
Trying to evolve activation functions. Have we seen that those activation functions would somehow go into a direction of higher dimensional?
Right, but that's an interesting question, of course. But the way they evolved based on the, you know, on backprop. So the objective is to optimize the objective function. The objective is not to make neural nets more robust. If you could somehow encompass that knowledge into the objective function, then they might learn more nonlinear activation functions. But I don't think people have ever done something like that.
Yeah. So for the adversarial inputs, you cannot guarantee anything, right? I mean, it could be that you just didn't find the adversarial example, you know, which are just a little bit of completely random noise, and still they are correctly classified.
It could be. Although we tried all kinds of, you know, techniques for generating those images. Of course, you know, we're searching, you know, highly dimensional space, right? And it's kind of, you can never guarantee that, you know, there's no some, you know, bizarre direction in which we didn't go. But, you know, there are probably of order 10 of different techniques for generating those images, like sine of the gradient, iterative gradients, you know, gradients with clipping, gradients inside the box, all kinds of modifications. We pretty much tried all of them, and we convinced ourselves that the effects that we see, they are properties of activation functions and not of the optimization method that is used for constructing those images.
We tried,
I don't want to say all the attacks because, you know, people inventing them every day, but we tried of the order of 10 different attacks.
But like, then one more other thing that I don't understand is, you can produce many, many examples. How do you check all of them? How do you say, you know, that this adversarially modified image is, you know, it has the features of, you know, it has some, like the noise has some of the semantic of what you wanted to corrupt. Like,
right. So what we did it in an empirical way. So we said, let's fix some method of producing those adversarial images. Let's say one step of the gradient and then take the sine of the gradient, or simply take one step. And then look at the transfer table, for example, or look at the adversarial images and try to see, and then change the method, and then repeat the whole thing. And basically, we changed the method 10 times, and we saw that, you know, for all different methods, we see the same result. After that, we thought that, okay, maybe it's enough.
Does this table make sense?
Yeah. Yeah, so this is the table that I didn't show, but essentially, this is the same transfer table, but for MNIST. So you generate images using different models that are shown here, and these are models that are used for the testing. And again, at the intersection, you see the error rates. So if you generate models, images of MNIST using models with n equals 2 and transfer them to n equals 30, then the error drops almost to, like, you know, normal images. Yeah.
Just a small practical question. So as you increase your n, do you observe any numerical issues due to the double precision or something like that?
Right, that's an interesting question. So on MNIST, we don't. MNIST is so simple that we can, you know, write our own optimizers and, you know, do training in, you know, in all possible ways, and we don't have any issues. With ImageNet, we do have some issues. And the issue is that somehow we could not make ADAM to optimize these highly nonlinear functions. And we believe that this is a problem of ADAM, but strictly speaking, we don't know. So somehow, you know, maybe there is some clipping of gradients under the hood or something of that sort that that prevented us from going above n equals 8. So n equals 8, it was pretty much the largest power that we could go to. And on MNIST, as you can see, we could go all the way to, you know, huge powers. We didn't have any problems. But yeah, in principle, you know, there might be some technical issues, but so far it doesn't look like those issues are conceptual.
So
nothing. I mean, we pretty much stopped at n equals 8. Yeah.
N is 20 here.
Oh, here we simply... here. This is MNIST, yeah.
So for... is my intuition correct in that, like, your different energy functions essentially define your basin attraction for each local minima is shaped differently. One is like L2 ball versus LN ball.
I wouldn't put it that way. It's shaped differently, but I don't think it's a question of norm, right? It's, you know, it would be nice to some kind of to analytically define that difference, and I don't think we have succeeded in that, but...
Okay, so but the intuition is that, for example, as n goes to infinity, mm-hmm. essentially nearest neighbors, right? Like,
yeah.
Right, so in some sense, it is kind of like comparing L2 to L infinity balls.
I'm not sure if that statement would be true. I mean, these functions, you keep them through the entire training procedure, right? So the weights, everything will depend on them.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure, you know, that it's easy to make statements like that. But I would like to get some, you know, analytical understanding of what is happening indeed.
Okay.
So we have some primitive results, but of course, you know.
Okay. A related common question mm-hmm. is that if you take n to be very large, wouldn't your gradient be essentially, like, every time you backprop, you essentially get gradient only from one of the options, right? Because it dominates.
Yeah,
the
exactly.
Size.
Yeah.
So.
And the trick is not to go to that extreme regime. So you would like n to be sufficiently large, but you would like to take advantage of cooperativity between two or three or four basins of attraction. But you don't want to a cooperation between 100 basins of attraction. Because once you are in that regime, then everything becomes fine-tuned. So one basin of attraction votes for two, and the other one votes for two minus epsilon. And they subtract each other, and the classification decision is hidden in the epsilon. And that's kind of the regime where traditional neural nets are at, and we would like to get away from that regime. So that's the idea. But yeah, you don't want to go to the regime of k nearest neighbors or something like that.
So let's thank Dmitry again.
Thanks.